I recently defended my doctoral thesis. In preparing for my own thesis defense, I watched many PhD defenses on YouTube. I watched a number of instructional videos on how to prepare for a thesis defense. I did a number of mock defenses with colleagues and advisors. Now that I'm done with the whole thing, let me put together my top 10 list of useful tips to help you prepare your own thesis defense. Number 10. This is a very obvious one. Read your own thesis. Most likely, your doctoral thesis is composed of multiple empirical chapters representing a series of studies that you have done through the years. It is also very likely, as a result of the submission and review processes, a specific empirical chapter is no longer the most up-to-date version of that study. Between the time of when the thesis was submitted and printed to the time of the actual defense, a few chapters may have gone through the revision process for various journals, so we really need to refresh our memory right before the defense which version of those empirical studies are actually in the thesis. So just give your thesis a quick read a couple of days before the defense. Number 9. Make use of reviewer and editor comments. The empirical chapters of the thesis have probably been submitted to academic journals for review and publication. As a part of that process, we must have been confronted with a large number of reviewer and editor comments and questions. Make use of them. Those journal reviewers are usually experts on the subject, and they have read our manuscripts very carefully, so their questions and remarks are usually very good ones. Use those questions in the preparation for the defense. Pretend that their questions are the ones that we need to respond to. I found this to be helpful. Number 8. Research your committee members. The committee members who will function as our opponents during the defense are likely to ask questions that are somehow related to their own expertise. It is very possible that they will look at our thesis from the perspective of their own topics. So look them up, read a few of their publications, look for presentations or speeches that they gave, get an idea of what kind of people they are so that we won't be surprised. Number 7. Know the rules and regulations and norms of your faculty. Obviously, different universities and faculties will organize their thesis defenses differently. For instance, are we allowed to contact the committee members beforehand and talk about our research? Can they give us an indication of the type of questions that they plan to ask? How about dress code? What's typically done with a reception? Is there a defense protocol? Look into these things so that we can be sure that we're not breaking any rules while taking full advantage of what the rules and regulations allow for. Number 6. Do a few mock defenses. Well, this is also an obvious one. But take the time to organize a few dress rehearsals with colleagues and fellow researchers following the format of the actual defense as closely as possible. Look, we chat with our colleagues about our research all the time, and we go to conferences, and we present our research and answer questions from the audience, but they are all different from the setting and the atmosphere of an actual defense. So, do a couple of mock defenses. They can be very useful. Number 5. Bring the right attitude and emotion. I know this sounds very vague, but the point is this. Don't fall into the wrong state of mind during the defense. We want to stay serious, but not too serious. We want to push back a little bit on our opponent's critical remarks, but we do not want to get too combative or too defensive. We want to stay pleasant and maybe throw in a couple of humorous remarks here and there, but we do not want to make too many jokes. So, remember to smile, be pleasant, be hospitable. Personally, I think the worst mistake one can make, or the biggest and most unfortunate downfall during a doctoral thesis defense, is to somehow fall victim of anger or a sense of defeat or despair or exhibiting the wrong emotions. That's just going to ruin it. So, be aware of our state of mind, be calm, be pleasant, and be in control of our own emotions. Number 4, don't be too nervous. But how? Well, in my experience, a few things help. You want to wear something in which you feel comfortable, in which you feel like yourself. I know that some people would buy a new suit to wear for the defense, but because it is a new suit, it feels new and it feels different and it feels awkward. That's not going to help with nerves, so I wouldn't do it. I'd rather wear something that I know I would feel comfortable with. What I also like to do is to chew some gum right before the defense. I know quite some people who say gum chewing makes them less nervous because this motion of chewing and eating does something to the brain. Something else which might be useful, take a deep breath every now and then. Take a little break, slow things down. Don't rush it. And finally, you can also simply acknowledge your nervousness. Tell the audience and the committee members that you feel a little nervous. In my experience, as soon as I tell the audience that I am feeling a little nervous, I already feel a lot better. You probably have your own tricks to deal with nervousness. Well, use them. Don't be too nervous. Now, the last few tips deal with answering questions. People can categorize potential questions into a number of categories. Questions about theories, questions about methodological issues, questions about data analysis, questions about practical implications, questions about theoretical contributions, so on and so forth. But if we think about it, when it comes to defense, there are really just two kinds of questions. Questions that we know the answers to, and questions we don't. So let's first talk about those questions to which we have an answer. So tip number three, let them finish their questions and give them a structured answer. Your opponent might take quite a bit of time to ask the question. They might say a lot in order to build up to their question. Fine, let them. It is actually a good thing that they're taking a lot of time. Obviously, don't interrupt them, don't rush them, let them talk, let them finish, thank them and compliment them for their great questions, and then give a structured and organized answer. You could say something like, I'd like to thank my highly learned opponent, Professor So-and-so, for this very interesting and important question. With respect to the issue of blah blah, I'd like to say three things in response. Firstly, secondly, and finally. Give the answer in a structured manner, thank him again, and move on to the next. Number two, what we can also do is we can make connections among questions. After we have responded to a few committee members, we might be able to make connections and links amongst their questions. So it is nice as part of our answer to a particular opponent to refer to an earlier question from somebody else. We could say something like, the issue of blah 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 is indeed a tricky one. Earlier, Professor So-and-so also touched upon this issue in his remarks. As such, I can imagine that a potential reader may indeed be confused about this issue, so let me clarify this a little bit further. Or let me add to what I already mentioned in my earlier response to Professor So-and-so. Because these committee members want to see that we are able to reason and think, so by making connections and links among their questions, we demonstrate this ability. And that's something nice. And now for tip number one. Let's talk about the questions that we have absolutely no idea how to answer. No matter how well we're prepared, and no matter how carefully and thoroughly we have done everything we possibly can, there will always be questions that we did not anticipate at all. Questions that we simply have no idea how to answer. And to be honest, sometimes we do not know how to answer a question because we're not well prepared. Sometimes it could also be because our mind just goes blank, or because we're nervous in this pretty intimidating situation, or maybe because it is just a question which is not answerable without first digging into the literature and thinking about it carefully. There may be many reasons for why we might just draw a blank and cannot answer a question. So what to do then? So this is my tip number one, and you might agree or disagree with it, but in my experience, it is helpful to have a routine prepared for when our mind goes blank and we are simply unable to answer a question. Now, this is not to say that we want to fake an answer. This is just so that we have something prepared, something respectful and intelligent to say for when we absolutely do not know how to answer a question. Perhaps something like, look, ladies and gentlemen, in the submission and review process of my papers, I was confronted with a large number of critical questions from reviewers and editors, and yet none of those questions touched on this very important issue that my opponent has just raised. And this really goes to show the level of critical thinking and attention to detail from my opponent here. But since this is the first time I am confronted with this question, I am genuinely not sure how to best answer this off the top of my head. Could we perhaps move to the next question and revisit this issue in just a moment? Or we can say something like, well, since this is the first time I am confronted with this question, I am genuinely not sure how to best answer this off the top of my head. However, I could think of a few issues related to the question. Perhaps I could mention these things in response. Look, I am sure you can come up with a better routine than I, but the point is, I believe it is best to prepare something respectful and polite to say for when we have absolutely no idea how to answer a question. It is, in my view, better to go with a pre-planned routine than to have dead air, because that's going to contribute to this sense of defeat and loss of control. So prepare a few routines, just in case. Now, in addition to these 10 things which I think we can do in order to prepare for the defense, there are also a few reflections that I would like to share with you all. These are not really tips per se or actions that we can take in order to prepare, but they are things that I think might be interesting or useful to know. The first point is this. Upon reflection, I believe if a questioner is being particularly tough on you, being unreasonably tough on you, asking you really difficult questions, impossible questions, you know what? It is not personal. The reason they're doing this is probably not because this person doesn't like you. It's probably because this person doesn't like your supervisor. Maybe this guy holds some kind of a grudge over your supervisor, maybe there is some tension or animosity between them, and that is why they're doing this, and you are simply the victim. So keep in mind this potential possibility. If an opponent is being really tough on you, it's probably not personal. It's probably not about you. Another thing is this. As a committee member, as a professor who is serving on the committee, this person would of course want to ask good and smart questions that are important and intelligent. They want to do justice to their own reputation and image. That is understandable, and it is not easy. They have to spend time reading through the entire thesis and then think of things which can be the basis for a good question, and then they have to formulate the question in an eloquent way. All that takes effort. But you know what? There is a difference between asking a question that is intelligent and important versus asking a difficult question that the candidate simply cannot answer on the spot. So, as a PhD candidate or as a student who is defending a thesis, when you are confronted with an incredibly difficult question which is almost impossible to answer, chances are this person who is asking you this difficult question is not trying to make it difficult for you, but rather their real motive is just that they are trying to seem smart in front of other professors and the audience. So again, don't take this personally. Go with your routine and just move on. And what you can also do is to politely toss the question back over. Because if the real reason that they're asking this very difficult question is so that they can seem smart, I'll bet you that they have an answer prepared and they're eager to tell it. So you could, of course, first make your own attempt at answering this question and then politely ask your opponent to share their thoughts and perspectives on that very question with the audience. And chances are they are quite eager and happy to do so. Okay, one more reflection. What do you think the most difficult kind of questions are during a defense? In my view, defense questions can come in three general flavors: asking for content explanations, asking for reflections and hypotheticals, or asking for you to refute an argument. Asking for explanations could be something like this. On page 120, you said this and that. Can you explain what you meant exactly? Or, can you explain this point in more detail? Can you elaborate a bit further? These questions are usually not that difficult. You have your thesis in front of you, you wrote the whole thing, you can explain. And then reflections and hypotheticals. An example could be this. Well, hypothetically speaking, if you were to redo the study described in Chapter 3, what would you have done differently? These types of questions are also, in my view, not that difficult. It is reflective and hypothetical, so feel free to speculate. I would say the most difficult type of questions would be when they present you with a very well-reasoned argument for you to refute. This can be difficult and tricky. An example. On page 76, you said this, and then on page 98, you said that. This clearly shows you subscribe to whichever theory or paradigm. Now, according to this publication by Professor so-and-so in this or that journal, they have concluded that this particular theory or measurement which you used is in fact invalid because of this or that reason. So, please explain what led to your decision to have chosen to use this particular outdated or invalid theory or measurement. This could be quite difficult. We could, of course, try to refute part of their premises or find flaws in their logic. But the bottom line is, they, the opponents, spend much time coming up with a question like this. But we do not have time to really think about this during the defense on the spot. Sure, if they gave you this question a couple of days beforehand, then we can prepare an answer. But hearing this question on the spot, with no time to think, with no opportunity to dig into the literature, it is very hard to really answer it well. So, feel free to give it a try. If it doesn't work, well, you have those routines. Finally, let me end on a positive note. Whether you are defending your thesis in continental Europe, or the UK, or North America, or Australia, wherever, the stats are clearly in your favor. Some people would say, oh, the British viva system is really tough, or compared with Europe, American universities are much more likely to fail you on your thesis defense. Well, it is true that there are some geographical differences. In some countries' universities, PhD defense is really more of a ceremony, whereas in others, it is more of an examination. But the fact is, failing a thesis defense is really rare, regardless where you are defending it. If you get to defend your thesis, you will most likely pass. A PhD candidate failing the thesis defense will reflect very poorly on the advisor, the committee, the faculty, and even the university. And also, if we think about it, one can only schedule a PhD defense once the thesis has been approved or at least preliminarily approved by the advisors and supervisors and relevant reviewers. If you are not ready, your advisors will not allow you to schedule a defense. So, if you get to defend your thesis, you will most likely succeed. The statistics are clearly and overwhelmingly in your favor, so just go for it. Alright, thanks for watching this Ranywayz random video. Please like and subscribe, and I'll see you next time.